We're all very excited for her talk. Everyone, please help me in welcoming Dr. Khabele.
Well, it's an honor and pleasure to be here. Can everybody hear me okay? Good. As mentioned, I'm going to switch gears a little bit from my typical scientific talk to really talk about the frustrations that we encounter in trying to make all the advances in ovarian cancer available to everybody. So I titled my talk "Over It" because we are over it, and we need to really address inequities in ovarian cancer outcomes for Black women. And I have a firm belief that if we're able to do that for Black women, it will help everybody. So, okay, for some reason that's not going. We practiced. That's working. Okay. I'm so sorry. There's something in the chat. Ah, there we go. All right, here are my disclosures. And the opinions expressed here are my own. And I want to just give you an overview of the treatment advances in ovarian cancer, discuss disparate outcomes for Black women diagnosed with ovarian cancer, and I will add, I'm going to focus a little bit more on what we could potentially do about it. And then I'll end with a personal perspective as a gynecologic oncologist and as a surgeon scientist. So this is a very common quote people put up when they talk about health and healthcare, and it was at a conference in Chicago. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. talked about, of all forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and inhumane. And I think that this is something that I think about on a daily basis when we're trying to take care of our patients in really difficult circumstances. So ovarian cancer is not that common of a cancer, but it's the fifth leading cause of cancer death in women. And there are about 23,000 cases diagnosed every year and about 13,000 deaths. It is more common among white women, but Black women have worse outcomes, more likely to be diagnosed at late stages of disease, more likely to not get the appropriate treatment. The risk of ovarian cancer is 1 in 78 for the general population, but there are increased risks related to hereditary cancer syndromes, such as BRCA1 and BRCA2 pathogenic mutations that run in families. So over the past, I would say, a couple of decades, advances in ovarian cancer care have significantly improved outcomes. We have mechanisms or methods and approaches for risk reduction, particularly for those patients who come from families with hereditary breast and ovarian cancer. So we can remove the fallopian tubes and ovaries before a person develops cancer, reduces their risk. We're able to diagnose ovarian cancer not as well as we would like at early stages of disease, but even with advanced stages of disease, our treatments have improved. And we've made significant strides in survivorship because patients are living longer with diagnosis and much improved our interventions towards the end of life and also with symptom management through palliative care. A group of us in the mid-2010s got together as members of the Society of Gynecologic Oncology and created sort of a task force to look at the literature and to write about what we were observing clinically with stark differences in outcomes for our Black patients who are diagnosed with ovarian cancer. And evidence suggests that equal care leads to equal outcomes for Black women. So there's nothing that's different between Black and white women at all on any sort of a biological basis. These were differences that we saw that were due to a lot of external factors that I'll talk about. But we knew that if a Black patient was involved in one of our cooperative group trials compared to a white woman involved in those trials, the outcomes were very, very similar. So I'm going to give you a couple of patient vignettes. This first patient, and so these are hypothetical patients, but the pictures are of actual patients I've cared for. So this is a 28-year-old Black woman, and this is an example of delayed diagnosis. So she had sought care for 12 months of abdominal pain, and she actually felt an abdominal mass herself. She was told she had fibroids, which is very common amongst Black women, and really was just told to follow up in a few months, and she kept seeking care. Eventually ended up in an emergency room. CT scan showed a large complex mass. In fact, it was so large, it was compressing the diaphragm, and her diaphragms were elevated. She was then referred to me, to a GYN oncologist. And we treated her with standard of care, which was an exploratory laparotomy. We removed this very large tumor intact, and she ultimately was diagnosed with stage 1A, grade 1 mucinous ovarian cancer, and did not require any additional chemotherapy, and was alive with no evidence of disease. So we know if we diagnose ovarian cancer at early stage disease, there's a greater than 90% survival. Unfortunately, over 60% of our patients are diagnosed with advanced stage. So this is a different patient, a 68-year-old Black woman who presented with abdominal bloating and discomfort. Her abdomen was similarly distended, but this time with ascites, malignant fluid. At this point, referred to me, we had several long discussions about proceeding with surgery. Because actually, this was when I was at Vanderbilt in Nashville, Tennessee, and there was a very common myth, folklore, that if you had surgery, if air hit it, it would spread. I don't know, has anybody heard that before? I mean, I had never heard this before. And so this was a couple of office visits to convince her that, you know, that probably the cancer had already spread and we really needed to go in and take care of it. But it's a very common myth that I ended up encountering. Never heard of it, having trained in New York. Over a decade ago, and now we have a combination of neoadjuvant chemotherapy, et cetera. But we spent hours in a radical optimal cytoreductive surgery, doing peritonectomy and just getting every piece of visible cancer we could see. And it was actually a really good surgery. She did really, really well. We gave her platinum-based chemotherapy, and unfortunately, she succumbed to disease within 2 years of her initial diagnosis. And so at that point, we didn't have as good of an understanding of the molecular features of tumors, but I would suspect she had a relatively platinum-resistant type of tumor. So we do know that even though most patients are diagnosed with stage 3 and 4 disease, patients are living longer with the diagnosis of ovarian cancer. And this is due to our understanding of radical surgery. So as anesthesiologists, you know you're in there with us as GYN oncologists, and we're looking for really the standard has changed. We are trying to seek R0, no residual visible disease. When I was a GYN oncology fellow, we were looking for leaving disease that was less than 2 centimeters. And then when I was attending, it was less than 1 centimeter. And now we're really very aggressive in trying not to leave anything behind. And so we understand that combining neoadjuvant chemotherapy could potentially help us achieve R0 disease. Regardless, platinum-based chemotherapy is the mainstay. 80% of patients have a really good response to initial treatment. And then of those patients, we then have followed initial cytotoxic chemotherapy with maintenance therapy, primarily with PARP inhibitors, which are newer drugs that have been FDA approved in the past few years. But ultimately, over time, symptoms come back, and at big centers like ours, we end up retreating patients over and over again with different chemotherapy regimens, but ultimately tumors become refractory. So we have a lot of work to do. This is for every patient diagnosed with advanced stage disease. We're really looking to improve outcomes and not just prolong life. So the PARP inhibitor story is incredible. I like showing this graph just from a statistical standpoint, this is a Kaplan-Meier curve. And, you know, this is on the y-axis is patients free of disease progression. It's a progression-free survival curve. Months are on the bottom. The blue line is olaparib, the PARP inhibitor that was the first to be FDA approved. And then the bottom line is in red is the placebo. So these are patients with advanced stage ovarian cancer who had completed platinum-based chemotherapy, completed their surgery. They were placed on olaparib versus placebo, and you can see the hazard ratio is 0.28. So they had, you know, almost an 80% higher chance of prolonged survival if they were on the drug versus the placebo. And I love these alligator jaws because we rarely see this in cancer. The separation between the curves is prolonged, and some patients have stayed on this drug for up to 2 years after initial treatment. And these curves are now translating into overall survival. So some GYN oncologists, dare I say, are whispering the word potential cure for advanced stage ovarian cancer based on these advances. We still are far behind other types of tumors as far as the holy grail of biomarker-targeted therapy. I just described to you initial treatment. We also have anti-angiogenesis therapy, primarily with bevacizumab or Avastin, and immunotherapy has been quite disappointing, but we do have some combinations with our standard of care treatment. Unlike, for instance, lung cancer, where you have a molecular target of an EGFR mutation, we really don't have that same kind of distinction in ovarian cancer. And you can see the reason I got involved in research is in our tumor boards, we would look at these tumors, high-grade serous ovarian cancer, and they all look pretty similar under the microscope. And then we would notice that people had a different response to therapy. And although 80% of patients respond to initial treatment, 20% have some sort of, the tumors have some sort of intrinsic resistance. We're now beginning to understand that for high-grade serous ovarian cancer, almost 100% have mutations in TP53, which is P53 is the guardian of the genome. And then about 51% have either mutations or deficiencies in the homologous recombination pathway. So these are patients who have, for instance, hereditary mutations in BRCA1 and 2. And then there's a group of patients who are able to repair DNA more efficiently, and that's about 49% of their patients. And a lot of work I do in my lab focuses on alterations in CCNE1 or cyclin E, and those patients account for about 20% of high-grade serous ovarian cancers, and those tumors have some intrinsic resistance to treatment. So it's very important to figure out either germline or what the tumor shows, whether it has a BRCA mutation or some sort of deficiency in the HR pathway, because that's going to be prognostic, but also has huge implications for a patient's family. So this third patient is a 32-year-old Black woman who's in good health with yearly visits to her gynecologic and primary care physicians. She had a very strong history of breast and ovarian cancer, and nobody had really recommended genetic testing to her. And she was finally pushed to get genetic testing after doing her own reading and recognizing that she had this, pedigree that showed both breast and ovarian cancer at young ages on her mother's side of the family. She underwent counseling and testing and was found to have a BRCA1 pathogenic mutation. And after shared decision-making and counseling, she underwent a risk-reducing hysterectomy BSO at the age of 35. So that's a typo there, not 25. So offering patients this option is really important to try to prevent the development of ovarian cancer and reduce risk. Unfortunately, through most of my career, until about 5 to 6 years ago, people really didn't think about offering Black patients genetic counseling and testing for a variety of reasons. One, there just wasn't an awareness that these mutations occur across all populations. We certainly had founder mutations in Ashkenazi Jewish populations, but these mutations occur across all populations. And the second reason is that some clinicians felt that Black patients wouldn't accept genetic counseling and testing, and there's literature to show that that's not true. So, you know, today I focus on ovarian cancer, but we know that in other types of cancers, uterine, cervical cancer, there are inequities and disparities in survival. In this, all races are blue, white population in red, Black population in green, and across the board, survival is lower for Black patients. This is not unique to gynecological cancers. The leading causes of death by sex among Black and white people. This is from 2016, and we could add COVID-19 deaths to this in this era. But you know, the death rate is disproportionately higher for Black patients compared to white patients, for both men and women. We know, just listing over and over again, health inequities for Black patients. Black patients are more likely to be diagnosed with late stage cancers, including breast cancer, less likely to be provided appropriate cardiac medication in emergency rooms when they present, less likely to undergo coronary artery bypass or transplant. They stay on dialysis forever if they have kidney failure. Just overall more likely to receive a lower quality of care, basic clinical services, such as intensive care. And since you're anesthesiologist, this was a simulated study, but it's been quoted quite a bit. And unfortunately, many of us see this play out in lots of clinical scenarios where there's racial bias in pain assessment and treatment recommendations between Black and white patients. You know, how many times have you seen, patients being thought of as drug seeking, or, their tolerance of pain is a little bit different. And so this was a study that asked people about their beliefs. And these are medical students and residents who were asked about whether they believe that there were differences in response to pain between Black patients and white patients. And there's this false notion of biological differences. And this has persisted to the present. And so I'm gonna take a step back and take us way, way back to the times of when Black people were enslaved in this country. And this is patient number 4, who's an 18-year-old Black woman who was participating in research that she had not consented to, but she had given birth to a child a couple of months prior to presentation and had not been able to hold her water. Essentially, she had a fistula, a very large fistula. Her bladder was destroyed, and this had left an opening between the vagina and the bladder, at least 2 inches in diameter or more. And that's a historic account from Dr. Marion Sims, I'll talk about in a moment. There were no good treatments available at that time. This was a horrific time in our country's history. Many of these women were forced to give birth because part of their job was to provide additional workers for the plantations and for that enterprise, the slavery enterprise. Interestingly, everybody had a name and there was some sense that these people who were enslaved were actual people. These are quotes from Dr. J. Marion Sims, who unfortunately is considered to be the grandfather of gynecology. And so you can imagine as a Black woman in this field, how there's some discomfort with that. And as a surgeon, this is one of the speculums he designed. And so this is something that we use in the operating room. But I want you to pay attention to some of how he describes, and this is taken from his memoir, his biography, The Story of My Life. He this is from 1884, and he proposed to owners of Negroes, if you will give me Annika and Betsy, for experiment. So he knew it was an experiment. I agreed to perform no experiment or operation on either of them to endanger their lives and will not charge a cent for keeping them. But of course, plantation owner or slave owner must pay taxes and must make sure they were clothed, but he'll keep them at his own expense. And then if you think about how he performed these surgeries, Anarcha underwent over 30 operations, okay? This was before the days of anesthesia initially, but then he still continued to perform these surgeries on Black patients after anesthesia was introduced. And once he perfected his surgeries, he would provide anesthesia to white patients who had fistula. This was the days before anesthetics, and the poor girl on her knees bore the operations with great heroism and bravery. So there had to be some concept that this was painful, but in order to perform this, I think there had to be some sense that maybe she didn't feel pain as much as other people. So that is very sobering, and there's been decades of work, particularly led by Black women, who have really felt that we need to recenter the patients who were operated on and not glorify Dr. Sims. And this controversial statue of J. Marion Sims, which was across the street from New York Academy of Medicine in Central Park, was taken down in 2018. So that's sort of the background here. Let's fast forward to the 2000s. And this is a landmark report from the National Academies talking about confronting racial and ethnic disparities in healthcare. And some of the language I think we need to add on to, but I think, and it was very basic of minority and non-minority. And I think we're changing the language around that. But I really like this. I like this to show that there are differences and then there are disparities. So what we do in medicine and the art of medicine and the science of medicine is trying to individualize and personalize care based on evidence, based on molecular features, based on clinical appropriateness. Is the patient fit for surgery? Is the patient, should the patient have an epidural or should the patient have an LMA? So these are clinical appropriateness decisions that we make every day that are based on our knowledge and based on the patient in front of us. Unfortunately, a lot of what we do, conscious or subconscious, gets layered on with the ecology of our healthcare systems. Just the complexity and the bureaucracy and the disparities that we experience every day, and even within our hospital system, and differences in care based on insurance, based on zip code. And this is what layers on and makes patient care a lot more difficult. Mm-hmm. There are huge societal costs to not addressing these inequities. If you do just a pure cost analysis, there's higher healthcare costs if you're diagnosing disease later. There's excess burden of disease with a higher disease prevalence if you're not preventing it. That's sort of health disparities. Then there's cost of care variation and quality of care changes if you're not providing standard of care, evidence-based care to everybody. Access to care, this is when you get into differences in socioeconomic status and insurance. And then you have social and environmental determinants of health. You have attitudes and beliefs, both of the clinicians and of the patients. You have literacy, health literacy or basic literacy of the patients. And then ability not only to pay, but perhaps to travel. And we see all of these things bear out. I'm just gonna put one slide up on some of the systemic barriers, but I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on that. But this just came out from our American Association for Cancer Research, looking at cancer health disparities and how redlining, actually systematic lending practices in major cities in the United States, throughout the United States, created some of these disparities. And this was race-based home lending zones called red zones in the 1930s. So, this now we experience this in safer neighborhoods that have green space, grocery stores, good public schools, high quality jobs, et cetera. less industrial pollution and house density. And then in hazardous neighborhoods, you have increased pollution, predatory tobacco marketing, you know, high house density, very little walkability green space, very few grocery stores. We talk about food deserts, poor public schools, poor quality jobs. And so interestingly, this one thing about medical facilities, we have to be really aware of. Most of the places I've trained and worked, the main medical facilities actually were in the red zones, something to think about. So, you know, the systemic factors, geographic versus, you know, rural versus urban. This is an issue when you have standard of care that's very complex. Do we want to regionalize care in the United States? Because not everybody, for instance, has access to a gynecologic oncologist. There are not that many of us in the country. When I trained, there were only 30 spots in the entire country. I think we're up to about 60 training spots in the country. It's not training that many of us. So even if you have regionalized centers, you know, it's not everybody can get there. There's low volume hospital and catchment areas. So do those hospitals partner with regionalized centers? I think telehealth may help with some of this. And of course, everybody dealing with lack of insurance, inadequate insurance policies, high premiums, lack of expansion of Medicaid to cover clinical trials, that limits care. So physician factors include, you know, a low volume surgeon is more likely to be taking care of patients who are in these hospital deserts or in rural areas or in areas where you don't have specialists, as I mentioned. And then there's biased decision making. And what we've been trying to do since the mid 20 teens is to incorporate these topics into national meetings and not make them an afterthought. And I'll talk a little bit more later about training a diverse workforce. The patient factors, I think we've spent a lot of time talking about, but there's fear and just the folklore, you know, when air hits it is one of them. And then there is mistrust in the medical establishment. For decades, we've been trying to increase culturally appropriate programming, and we change the name of it every couple of years or so. We need to find ways to make it stick. So with clinician and physician health stereotypes, I've already talked about those three vignettes. A pelvic mass in a Black woman, that's a fibroid. Okay, so we're actually looking at medical school curricula to make sure that you're not doing that sort of heuristic kind of automatic Black woman fibroid, Black patient sickle cell, you know, like you have to think beyond those kind of simplistic ways that I was taught when I was in medical school. I was taught that BRCA mutations are primarily and hereditary breast and ovarian cancer was something that we needed to be concerned about in Ashkenazi Jewish populations. But now we understand, fast forward decades, that this is beyond, although there are founder mutations, and we're discovering now that they're founder mutations from West Africa and the Caribbean that are unique to Black patients. And then there's assumption that Black women are not willing to undergo treatment. And I think it becomes circular. So my mother was diagnosed with AML, and I brought her to Vanderbilt for treatment. And it's interesting. She looked 20 years younger than her stated age, and flirted with her oncologist and got on a clinical trial. But some of the residents and fellows who rounded on her when she was getting ready to undergo stem cell transplant really just treated her, you know, it was really funny. It wasn't funny. It was astonishing to see how she was treated like a child. Even though she had made like this decision to go on a clinical trial, she was very much aware of the decision making. You know, she was educated, but there was an assumption about her knowledge and her willingness to undergo different treatments and the amount of navigating kind of inserting that I had to do to ensure that she just sort of stayed on track with her care. I think that happens a lot for us who are in healthcare, who have our own diseases or are taking care of family members, but there was like a heightened piece of that layered on assumptions about who she was as a Black woman, elderly Black woman. So these are some of the stereotypes. A lot of work I did in Nashville was going to churches and going to communities and talking about, you know, we can say the word cancer. There's also a myth that if you don't want to speak it into existence, so you don't want to say the word, because if you say the word, you speak it into existence, then you have it. So conversations about, well, if you say the word, this means then we can treat the word, and just being really gentle about and asking people how they wanted the information to come to them. So that's, you know, saying the word, not claiming it is very Southern. This is a lot of stuff I dealt with when I was in Nashville. And then there's a lack of trust to doctors and physicians and not wanting to be a guinea pig. And especially in the Black community, you know, I talked to you about Lucy Anarcha and Betsy J. Marion Sims subjects in his experiments. But, you know, we have the syphilis experiment and others where patients were really not properly consented or did not understand what they were going through and were basically used as guinea pigs in some of these studies. So the mistrust is reasonable and valid, I think. And I think that the onus is on us to listen. One of the issues that came to mind as I've been doing ovarian cancer work is that ovarian cancer survivors are very vocal. They're not as many of them as breast cancer survivors. But what they're telling us is you need to listen to us, listen to patients, listen to women. Many patients are diagnosed late because they keep going to the gastroenterologist, they get a colonoscopy, they get an upper GI, and they're not being referred to the proper specialist. And there's data from the late 1990s talking about the fact that patients, that ovarian cancer is not silent. It's not a silent killer, which is what I was told in medical school, that patients actually are screaming to the rooftops and not getting the proper diagnosis. And that's not just Black women. It's patients diagnosed with ovarian cancer across the board. We need more funding for ovarian cancer can research. We need to take detailed histories, learn about symptoms, and learn about family history. But I think the onus is on us to be more trustworthy. I mean, we have, I think that we've all experienced such trauma through these COVID-19 surges and all sorts of things that are happening. We're still going through it and reproductive rights and justice right now. And the Supreme Court overturning of the Roe v. Wade with the Dobbs decision. There's just a lot that we have to do to continue and be persistent in working on being trustworthy partners in taking care of patients, their families and communities. And patients have their own expertise. Communities have their own expertise. And I think it's important to respect and acknowledge that. We have medical knowledge, but we also have our lived experience. And sometimes the physician is the patient. One really wonderful example of how this is done is through my colleague, Kemi Dahl, who's a gynecologic oncologist at University of Washington in Seattle. She has PCORI funding that then spun out into this group called ECANA, Endometrial Cancer Action Network for African Americans. And it's really led by a group of advisors and advocates, and it's peer-to-peer training, support groups, and really educating patients to make peace with your doctor. You know, if you really don't have that therapeutic relationship, it's okay to find another opinion if you can, learning how to advocate for yourself. And so little bit of time after I started working here, I ended up collectively, a group of us, this was after George Floyd was murdered. I started here at WashU in June of 2020. My family hadn't moved here yet. I was just really down about everything. And I got on some national calls, but this is where Zoom helped. And a couple of us are leaders in a variety of ways in OBGYN. And so we recorded our Zoom conversations and came up with some narratives that sort of described our own experiences as Black people in medicine. And I had not told this story I guess it took like many, many years. Our son is 23, so it took 20 plus years for me to tell this story. But I delivered my baby where I trained in New York. And this just describes that I arrived in labor, had painful contractions. I was freaking out because I knew the literature. Actually, in New York City, Black women are 9 times more likely to die in childbirth than white women. So this is, you know, Columbia, 168th Street. We lived on 142nd Street. I check in. It was a disaster. We are a Black couple from Harlem. You know, they're questioning. So my husband and I have different last names. So he's the father of the baby. You know, so this is what our patients tell us happens in hospital systems. And here, Columbia, Mount Sinai, treated with indifference is a nice way to say it. So anyway, I'm an OBGYN. I was a fellow in gynecologic oncology, and I requested an epidural. The nurses laughed at me. So they're just like, really? And so I was really, in the first time in my life, I became silent. So my husband knew I was in pain. And so he tried to intervene, but he needed to be really calm because we've seen this before where the family member gets agitated and what happens? They call security. So this was a very tense time. And so finally, the on-call attending happened to be a Black woman. He goes and he whispers in her ear and says, can you call Hilda, who was my OBGYN? Just let her know Dineo's here. So this is privilege, right? Privilege of having somebody he could feel comfortable talking to. And Hilda came in night of Thanksgiving, before Thanksgiving, to deliver. Got my epidural. As soon as she walked on the floor, everything was, she just kind of set stuff right. Well, why? She was the dean. She was an associate dean at Columbia. She was my mentor in medical school. So she kind of talked to people and talked people down and set it right. But this shouldn't have to happen. And I'll never forget how I felt. And this is what patients tell us. Thank you for saving my life. But you know what? You made me feel like. So this is some of the word cloud we got. You know, Kevin Holcomb talked about Lucy Annaker and Betsy. He didn't know her name. He didn't know as a gynecologist anything about that history. Dr. Connors talked about wanting to be heard. She was an MFM in the ICU and people didn't know she was the attending. They kept talking to the medical student. She was the attending in charge. Linda Bradley talked about, as a medical student, witnessing just an inappropriate exam in the emergency room. So we need to train more Black doctors, nurses, and healthcare workers. But I would say there's not enough of us to be a Hilda, right? There's not enough of us. So we all have to pick up the slack because there's only 32% of oncologists are women. Only 2.3% of oncologists identify as Black or African-American. Only 7.8% of nurses are Black. So we need to eliminate inequities in ovarian cancer care and other healthcare. It's the right thing to do. It makes economic sense. And again, if we can be a Hilda for every patient, it'll improve care for all. These are just statistics that we know. The blue is percentage of all active physicians by race and ethnicity. This is Black or African American physicians overall. In medical schools, it's 3.6%. In OBGYN, which has more Black women going into it than other fields, these are the numbers here. In OBGYN academic medicine and science, women in OBGYN, 83% of our residents are women, 58% of our faculty are women, only 28% are chairs. Although Black women are going into OBGYN, there's a 16% decline. So they're leaving, they're entering and they're not finishing, or they're not going into the field. 4.6% Black women in medicine, fewer than 1% of Black women leaders in medicine, and only 0.1% of Black women with NIH funding. I'll just leave that there. So, I'm a member of the Society of Black Academic Surgeons, and so you'll see this trend. When I get irritated, I start calling my colleagues and we start writing. So this was a call to action between the Women in Surgery Committee and the Health Disparities and Health Inequity Committee. We were the chairs of this committee, and a call to action. Black African-American women surgeon scientists, where are they? In 2020, there were no Black women chairs of surgery departments in the country, of academic medical centers. And 2021, there were three, and they're all my friends. They're like, it's just, there's so few. Andre Hayes Jordan just became chair at Howard. K. Murray King's at Albany. Karen Gibbs is at Yale New Haven, which is a big system affiliated with Yale. And so advocacy, 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 but it's very, very frustrating. So as I wind down, I always put a reverse history up. This is where I am here. This is where I've been. This is some of the stuff I've done. This is where I focus. These are my titles. But what's really helped me on the journey is over here. Every step of the way, I have benefited from targeted career development programs that were targeted towards people who weren't traditionally medicine people. And we know that most students going into medical school have some family member who was a doctor. So how do you get people who don't have that background? I've had lots of role models and supporters. I've had lots of mentors and sponsors, and I've learned how to mentor and sponsor myself and coach myself along the way. Motivators are tormentors and silent bystanders. One of my favorite tormentors was when I went to a British prep school in Southern Africa, and Mr. Keegan, I still remember his name, was my chemistry teacher. And in the British system, you do the O levels and A levels, and you prepare for O levels, but there's specific courses or classes that you're gonna take your exams in. So he wrote this long letter to my parents that I had no aptitude in science. And that was sort of a mistake, because my mom's Black American and Texan, and like she like rolled up her sleeves and marched down to that school and had a talking to Mr. Keegan. Needless to say, I finished my high school in Austin, Texas, and had the option to eventually become a surgeon scientist. So my family is important to me, and my father's South African, and tribute to our South African heritage, Dr. Avedon. It always seems impossible until it's done. So I'm happy to answer any questions, and thank you. Thank you for your time. I guess there may be questions on the chat too. I have to see. Oh. I'm sorry, I have to do a shout out to Fumi Adebayo, or Fumi Adonis. She and I go way back, way, way back when she was a student at Meharry. She rotated in my lab at Vanderbilt and would follow me into the ORs. So happy we're in the same place. Any questions? Yes.
About the decline in Black residents, what factors do you think that is about, like, is it because of the more punishments for Black residents and white residents?
Yeah, so actually we're working on this through SBAS, and AAMC has looked at this. This is across all specialties, but in particular the surgical subspecialties. People are not finishing, and we're trying to figure out why. Anecdotally, people are saying, you know, there's just different rules. So somebody is learning a new clinical technique, Black resident versus a white resident. And if the Black resident makes a mistake and then makes another mistake, perhaps makes a third mistake, then it sort of gets imprinted. Well, they weren't qualified anyway. So white resident makes a mistake and makes us make, oh, we're learning. Everybody, we're kind of learning. So these are anecdotes that are coming to us, and it's really, really hard to as to what to do about it, because you know, many of us are the only or the one. So you report, who do you report it to? It's not going to be anonymous. I fill out these national surveys, you know, at this point, if you ask, okay, what is your age between blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah? Where do you practice Midwest? What's your rank, professor? It's going to be me in every survey. I mean, that's not anonymous. So I think it's really hard to get the data because people don't want to say anything because they're afraid that they will be punished. And we kind of see this happen sometimes, you know. So in my role right now, I'm trying to figure out ways to change our culture, to change how we talk to each other in medicine and surgery and science, to acknowledge that none of us is perfect. We're all learning. And, you know, many of the mistakes we make are how we learn. We learn from challenges. And that is a difficult cultural shift. It's a mind shift. So I think that's part of it. People are not finishing. I think that I worry with the post Roe v. Wade being overturned that people are not going to want to do OBGYN because it's going to be much more difficult to practice across the country. And so I think that there are a number of factors. It's hard training. Yes.
Dr. Khabele, that was excellent. It was an excellent talk. So I want to ask you a question regarding the disparities in outcomes in oncology, because in anesthesiology, we've seen some disturbing statistics as well, and not only in adults, but in children.
Mm-hmm.
So although we would never imagine that we would treat a child differently or the outcome would be different, there are statistics that say that it might be so.
Yeah.
So instead of saying that this, it happened and oh God, you know, could you describe how you began and how do you begin to get what might be the problem or what might be occurring in that situation where we might be affecting an outcome in a child?
Well, I mean, I think we get tangled up in what is really happening. I hope that I was able to give you examples of what happens sort of subconsciously, what happens, you know, systematically. So you put all of these things together and it's a messy soup, right? So I gave my own story because I'm trying to describe what happens when, you know, I wasn't in my suit. I didn't say I trained here. Nobody knew I was a doctor. I was a regular Black person walking into the hospital. And the moment I stepped foot in that hospital, I mean, I don't have high blood pressure, but I did that day, right? Because it's like, you don't want to do anything wrong because you want to survive, you know, and having some sort of sense that that is what patients experience. And then if you're a child, parents trying to advocate and, you know, culturally, you know, I may have a loud voice when I'm trying to advocate for myself. So now you're going to get mad at me because my child is in pain. You know, I'm trying to help your child. So then it sets up this thing, right? And so I think that there are ways to continue to do a lot of this workshopping work and simulation and discussing, and it's not, these are not abstract concepts. These are really concrete life or death decision-making concepts. I sort of think about, you know, what we have to do as a family. Like when my son started driving, we had that talk. You get stopped by a police officer, you know, 10 and two, you don't say anything. You look straight ahead, you know, because it's survival. And explaining that in ways that people understand that it's not, you know, people are upset not because they're upset at you personally, but their lives are difficult, you know. Also, what I've been trying to do from a patient and community side is advocate for us as healthcare people. You know, we show up every day. We show up and we do really hard things and we're here to help. Sometimes we don't have all the tools we need to help, but, you know, is there a way we can lower the temperature in the room to then say, you know, we both want the same things for your child, for you. It's very hard to study some of this stuff, but I think that qualitative data actually has a role here. And not just because I showed you statistics and we know these statistics, you know, and people still keep trying to veer towards biological differences. And so I showed you that slide about J. Marion Sims, because I think it's very, very hard to say that you want to do this type of experiment on somebody unless there's something in your brain that says, ah, they must be different. Because it's that, you know, you have to. So qualitative workshopping, simulation, continuing to talk about it. Yes.
Thank you for that talk. Just following up on that question. I train mostly in the UK and I find the American health system not an impossible to get my head around.
So do we. Yeah.
I think there are any low-hanging fruits, and I'll keep it specifically to gynaecology.
Yeah.
That one could intervene either at a patient level or a systemic level.
Yes.
That you think could close some people with inequities.
Yes. I think we need to really think more about patient navigators or community health workers and or doula kind of person. So you know, for my mother, I was her doula for her stem cell transplant. For me, my husband was my doula, right? You need somebody, and I don't think it should be a family member. So those are not the best examples, but that's all we had. But I think it helps to have, you know, somebody who can translate. Well, what they're really trying to say is, you know, this is what's going on. Oh, what your doctor is really trying to say is this. Or, you know, don't push. She understands. Just give her a moment. Give her a moment to think about it. Like, we want to get things done. We want to get here and there. I'll give you a great example that happened to me the other day. The patient didn't want to go. She didn't want to be rolled back to the OR. She's a patient who has young woman with endometrial cancer. Her BMI was 82. We had treated her with hormonal therapy to try to get her to lose weight and get bariatric surgery, and then we would do surgery for endometrial cancer. That plan did not work. She ended up, despite high doses of the hormonal therapy to treat it, she ended up bleeding through and having pain. So we decided to just operate risky, yes. But we wanted to proceed. This is 2 weeks after the Dobbs decision, and our hospital's policy is for a urine pregnancy test. So this woman is BMI of 82, 39 years old, PCOS, never been pregnant, could never get pregnant, is on high dose hormonal therapy. That means she's not pregnant. We did an ultrasound showing there's no pregnancy, and the hospital policy is you need a urine pregnancy test before we take you back. So she had a meltdown. She was like, if you all make me pee in a cup, I'm going to book. So then everybody's like, oh, patient's upset. So my fellow, who's our first Black male fellow in GYN oncology here, was operating with me that day. He went in. You know, it didn't work with me because I'm a surgeon and she was mad at me. He went in and she calmed down. We did not do a urine pregnancy test. I documented she's not pregnant and we got her back. But it set up this spark because she was upset, and you can understand why she's upset. I'm about to do a hysterectomy so she can, I'm making sure she could never be pregnant. And then you're asking me for a pregnancy test. So, but having that other person, you can de-escalate, you can call somebody in and just have some, you know, instead of pushing individually, get another person in. And he's got such a great bedside manner. And that's all she talks about. Plus he's cute, right? So she's just like, you know, where's that doctor? Like, okay, fine. So I think that there are ways to have that sort of third party, whether it's a doula in OB or a patient navigator, community health worker. We're doing a lot of group prenatal care in OB, where you have your peers who are disseminating the medical information. And so I think that there's different ways to do this. It's not, the onus is not solely on the clinician. Yes.
Thank you so much for sharing this work and these stories with us today. I wonder in the last minute if you could just tell us a little bit about what the panel this evening is about.
You mean with the Danforth campus? Oh, yes. Okay. So we are this, it's a series. And Dr. Tessa Madden and I are the first part of the series. And we're just going to talk a little bit about definitions of, reproductive healthcare. We're going to talk about some of the implications that the Dobbs decision has had on our care. And, you know, I'll spend a little bit of time talking about reproductive justice in Black women and abortion that's been restricted for, you know, almost immediately after Roe v. Wade was passed into law in the 1970s. And then I'll talk a little bit about the chilling effect. So we've a couple of editorials I've participated in have sort of written about the chilling effects. So the example I gave you is the chilling effect of the post-Dobbs decision. So the trigger law in Missouri is specifically towards abortion. So there are very few people that law directly applies to, but the chilling effect is that people then don't want to take care of anybody who's pregnant. So now the chilling effect is if you have lupus or rheumatoid arthritis and your reproductive age, I don't want to prescribe you methotrexate. That has nothing to do with that abortion law. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about that. And then Tessa Madden will talk a little bit about her experience. All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.